Isn't Halloween just such a great time of year? I love to get into all the spookiness of the season, as you can see. But you know what? I'm all about Daikaiju. So there's gotta be some form of kaiju media that's, you know, legitimately scary, right? Alexa, what's the scariest Godzilla film?
According to popular opinion, the 1954 classic Gojira is considered to be the most terrifying film in the Godzilla series, and is commonly referred to as a horror film.
Yeah, but it's not really scary though, right?
Sure, the original film dealt with a ton of dark themes, could be genuinely disturbing at times, and served as a cautionary tale of the dangers of nuclearization, but the film isn't necessarily a horror film, as many like to hyperbolically make it out to be.
There's gotta be some medium that Godzilla's touched that can make me feel genuinely scared in my seat, you know? Something that leaves me unable to sleep at night. Something that leaves a real lasting impact on the fandom as a whole. It's a creepy and cool design, but not scary enough.
Really going for the original jokes here, aren't we?
It's a fun game, but it's not scary at all. If you've somehow never heard of it, this is the NES game Godzilla Monster of Monsters, or as the title screen would lead you to believe, Godzee Monster of Monsters. A pretty classic side-scrolling, button-mashing experience on the original Nintendo console. But what could be scary about an NES game?
Jake, it's me, Taylor Minster, your best friend and pal. I brought your favorite Halloween dish, pasta with creepy shapes.
Oh, thank you, Taylor. Of course! A creepypasta!
Creepypastas, the rabbit hole of internet horror stories that made you lose sleep at the age of 13 and made you laugh hysterically at the age of 14. These urban legends have been published by authors all over the world for years now, with certain subsections of creepypasta becoming very popular. One of these was the
Haunted Video Game Creepypasta.
Stories that took your classic, cute childhood game and tried to turn it into pure nightmare fuel.
Keyword, try.
Many of these come across as just downright laughable nowadays, but for many of us, these tales would be the bane of sleep our first time reading through.
And that's what brings us here today. Among these video game creepypasta tales, one of the most infamous and well-known has to be the NES Godzilla Creepypasta, written by Cosby Daff.
This tale centers around a boy named Zachary, a G-fan who has received a copy of Monster of Monsters from his friend Billy, only to find that the cartridge displays many anomalous properties, from inserting monsters into the game that wouldn't debut until after its initial release, to just saying f*** it to the NES's graphical capabilities entirely. Along the way, he encounters a demon-like creature that inhabits the game simply named Red, as well as an original kaiju, Solomon. Zachary soon finds that he may have tampered with something he shouldn't have, and an 8-chapter-long journey ensues.
This creepypasta has become rather infamous in the Godzilla community, as it's one of the only real horror stories relating to Godzilla out there, and nothing else has really become quite as iconic as this has.
But when we look back at it, does it really stand above all the other video game creepypastas out there? Well, obviously for one, this creepypasta is definitely made by a Godzilla fan for Godzilla fans. A huge roster of the Godzilla cast is present in this story, with numerous other references made in the text.
However, it does kind of take a toll on the pacing, as a lot of the story winds up devolving into... But Orga wasn't in the original game!
And that couldn't be right, because Orga didn't debut until Godzilla 2000, but the game came out in 1988.
And explaining every aspect of their boss fight.
Again, this works extremely well as being a text version of a fan remake of sorts of Monster of Monsters, and Cosmodav really puts a lot of effort into giving each new monster its own identity in the boss battles, and even every standard monster in the stages, rather than just having them thrown in there for the sake of having Gorosaurus or Space Godzilla or something in the original NES game. And on that note, this creepypasta contains some phenomenal sprite work, all done by Cosmodav as well. I mean, some of these sprites match the style of the original game so well you could hardly tell the difference. Hundreds of specially made images accompany the story, which really just helps with the overall immersion, and it really gives you a great visual of what's going on and makes it all just feel that much more believable. And speaking of believable, this creepypasta features something that not a lot of video game creepypastas actually seem to have.
Build up!
Yeah, getting through this creepypasta is actually something that will take a couple hours to do. A lot of these types of stories wind up being pretty short and, as such, tend to try and crank all the dials up to 11 really fast, to the point of it just becoming laughable. But Cosmodav really does a good job of building up the game's anomalous properties over a long period of time. Hell, the first world has practically nothing different about it at all, and the game functions basically normal. Red's first appearances are as heart-pounding as ever, and everyone remembers that feeling of terror when Red first broke the fourth wall. Plenty of the normal stages feature very weird and sometimes really disturbing elements as well. Each world brings the player through every level, talking through all of their mechanics and properties. Like the boss battle explanations, some may view these as boring, and sometimes, yeah, they can be. But I think it really helps with the buildup of the whole story. Every chapter you experience the game's gradually growing disturbing nature, anxiously awaiting what the world's finale will be like. Factors like Face, the quiz guy, keep you on your toes, making you feel like there's something always watching your every move. Though while it has a good build-up and even great, really disturbing elements at times, the last stretch kind of makes everything fall apart. Like I said, it's got fantastic sprite work, and I absolutely commend and admire Cosmodav for the incredible amount of work he put into it. But I find a lot of the last world, Zenith, to just be... dumb. A hybrid monster. I mean, it's cool and great sprite work, but it just feels kind of out of place, even by this creepypasta standards. The hyper-realistic level. Actually, gotta give props real quick, the term hyper-realistic is not uttered even once in this entire story, so good job there. This level just, again, feels... out of place. Like, obviously the game is haunted and stuff, but something about this level of detail, coming from any sort of NES cartridge, haunted or not, just takes a sense of immersion out for me. Really disturbing designs though, and the sprite work is some of the best I've ever seen. Maybe it's just me, but hyperrealism just doesn't really do it for me. The hell level. Same thing as the last one, though in my opinion not nearly as unbelievable. Just something about a supposed NES cartridge giving this much detail makes me feel more disconnected from the story than it's supposed to. Why is Zachary even given the opportunity to fight Red? If he one-hit kills him earlier in the game, why now is he suddenly allowed to have a chance against him? And it's because Red gives him a chance that he ultimately loses. Like some demon. The game keeps taking screen caps. Why? Yeah, the game is haunted and shit, but... there's literally no reason the game would be taking screen captures of itself just to have some documentation of its final fight. Unless Red is really trying to get some clickbait articles online made about him, but it just feels super forced and is meant to give you a reason that we have awesome sprite work of the final battle. Again, it looks great, but it just takes you out of the story. Red's final form is kinda goofy looking. Like, his base form is actually kinda creepy and disturbing, but his flying and swimming forms were already taking a bit of that away. But man, this thing is just kinda cheesy, honestly. Especially when he eats a monster.
I killed Melissa.
The whole girlfriend subplot for Zachary and Red is just unmotivated and feels like a complete shoo-in to give some sort of emotional connection to the game. Like, yeah, I get that Zachary's supposed to feel responsible for Melissa's death, but it kind of ruins itself by just being all,
"Oh yeah, I'm a literal demon, and I actually killed her, so yeah, you didn't do anything, but now I'm gonna kill you too."
What's up with Solomon and Red? Like, yeah, I get they clearly have a history or something, but it comes literally out of left field and has no real payoff, aside from Solomon saying he'd rather die than serve Red. And then he dies. Like, what's the point? Deus Ex Acacius. I guess Solomon could be argued for being the same thing, but he actually gets killed in the final fight. Acacius, or the Golden Light, doesn't even have some shoehorned in backstory to give some relation to either Red or Solomon. I guess it's technically Melissa having some sort of effect on the game, but that just raises more eyebrows, and I've already got both of mine up. Like, why is she able to communicate in the game now? What makes her special aside from being Zack's girlfriend? How come she gets to have control over the game too in some capacity? Is she an angel? I get that the happy ending is supposed to be deserved for Zachary, given all the stuff he goes through playing the game, but man, it just comes across as really cheesy. Like, hey, all your friends are back, including Face, your bestest pal, the quiz guy. Didn't you miss him? I get that it probably would have been worse to have a dark and gruesome ending, but there's a fine line between a cheesy good ending and something that just leaves you properly satisfied.
I've known you for a long time.
And other questions that will remain unanswered. I get that it's important to leave stuff open for interpretation, but when something as big as this pertains to the whole motive of the game's anomalous properties, and with zero hints as to what it could possibly mean, leaving it unanswered just leaves a total feeling of dissatisfaction. Now, I suppose maybe that's the point, really putting us in Zachary's position, where we don't know at all. But when the story makes it such a huge note to bring up again in the epilogue, it makes you question exactly what the point of it was. And finally, why does he sell it on eBay? Okay, it's explained why, because he doesn't want the responsibility of owning the cartridge anymore, but on such an open platform like eBay, anyone could buy it. And what if they experience its anomalous properties too? Isn't it then on you if anything bad happens to them because you allowed them to experience that cartridge? He does give a warning at the end of the story, telling people that they should shut it off if it starts to act weird, but again, eBay is totally open. And what if someone buys it without reading the story, or reading the description he probably has on the item? I'm not saying it's the most likely thing in the world, but given that he wants to get rid of it so badly, it's a definite possibility. But on that note, I suppose I should quickly touch on the sequel story, NES Godzilla Replay. I won't talk about it much since currently it is incomplete, but it does follow the story of the person that does buy the game off of Zack. As I've been reading through it, it lacks a lot of the things that made the original story kind of iconic. The build-up, the genuinely disturbing imagery, all of that. But it doesn't seem to want to go that direction quite yet. With the exception of the Warlock, maybe? If it's ever finished, I'd like to cover it. Cosmedaf's fantastic sprite work is on display once again, and the story seems to want to explore different sides of the anomalous cartridge, which could be a very interesting read going forward. It's already pretty engaging, honestly. So, after all the criticisms I've just given, you may think that I'm not a fan of this creepypasta, but in reality,
I love this story.
When you put aside all the dumb tropes, all the dumb cliches, all the cheesy moments, all the nonsensical occurrences, this creepypasta has become a staple of the Godzilla community. Everyone knows Red's demonic face. Everyone can quote that Solomon is still the best, 1973. I've even named an episode of Zone Fighter after one of the small levels that Cosmedav created. This story has left such a huge impact on the entire fandom, it's absolutely insane. And I'm right in that crowd of people who love to bring this out every year around Halloween and give it a listen. Oh yeah, I should mention that if reading through isn't quite your thing, my good pal Goji73 did a fantastic read-through of the entire creepypasta, complete with music tracks that enhance the mood, and his own visual flair that brings a ton of the story to life, you know, on top of the great narration. I've listened to it countless times already, and I'm sure I'll keep coming back to this creepypasta every Halloween. I've linked both to the original written text as well as Goji73's narration in the description below. Be sure to check them out. And check out CosbyDaff on DeviantArt, he does fantastic work outside of the creepypasta as well. Now, before we end this off, there's one more aspect of this creepypasta that I want to cover.
Did you know it's an actual game? Being made by CosbyDaff?
It's not yet completed either, but it looks fantastic so far. And a demo has even been released on GameJolt. Link also in the description.
But hey, I've got an actual cartridge right here. Well, I actually got it from a garage sale about 35 miles from my house. An old man gave it to me for free, but I said I couldn't take it for free, so I traded him some Ultraman Fusion cards for it. The old man said he got it from my cousin, and my cousin said that he got it from my uncle who works at Nintendo, and he said that he got it from my good pal Goji73. But I'm sure there's nothing creepy about it.
Yellow.
Jake, I know what you're thinking, but do not do it.
John, is that you? Calling me to ask when your next role in Zone Fighter's gonna be?
Jake, I'm being serious. I gave that game to your uncle, who works at Nintendo, who gave it to your cousin, who gave it to that old man, for a reason. That game is dangerous. Do not play it.
Nah. Well, maybe just in case. Hey, Taylor. Would you like to play this game?
Oh, sure.
So I should tell you, there's like this whole convoluted story about the game being haunted and stuff, and it was obtained by a boy named Zachary, who got it from his friend Billy. And the game actually like puts a lot of new Godzilla monsters into the game, which is actually like pretty cool, and there's a ton of new stages and stuff. But it turns out the game's actually haunted, and it's possessed by a demon named Red. And there's like all sorts of like hell and flames and stuff in the game, and the game like actually hurts Zach when he plays it, and he almost dies, which is actually like kind of an
okay,
excited.
Do you just want me to play the goddamn game or not? Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I would like to give a special thank you to Patreon supporters GWRZilla, Justice, Liquid Pestar, Jimmy Moore, Jeff King, Johnny Sacco, Jaws Infinity, and a very special thank you to Ultriab. If you would like to learn how you can get your name listed at the end of each of my videos as well, in addition to some other awesome rewards, then be sure to visit patreon.com/daikaijulegends.